reads an endless interviews. Got host reports written how to cross for eternity. And it's off to the end for my innkeeper friend. What's the name and drink out of me? Then it's back to my room where I resume my attempt to write ahead. Just me and my beer and a terrible fear that I might be losing it. And it's hard, it's hard. It's hard to be the bar. I don't know how I do it. There's only so much of me to go around. I got so many fans with so many demands. I can hardly go take a piss. You beat a freak on these autographs, because they all want a piece of this. It's a cross that I bear, and like Jesus, I swear is a burden, but I suffer through it. It's all part of the game, the traffic's a fame, but somebody's gotta do it. And I know, I gotta go and get back to my pen. Don't make me do it, don't make me go through it. Stop it, it can't be a drink. Cause it's hard. So much more fun. You see, what people just don't understand is that writing's demanding, it's mentally challenging, and it's a bore, it's such a chore to sit in a room by yourself. Oh my god, I just hate it. And you're trying to find an opening line or a brilliant idea, and you're pacing the floor and hoping for, yeah, just a bit of divine intervention. That one little nugget, that one little spark, then you ring and you find that you're ready to start. It's an anchor, right? Right? Wrong, you're not even close. You remember the damn, your play's gotta be an iambic. The lights flashing in my face. You're completely in the dark. I've already messed up three lyrics of a song that I'm known for. This is not going well. This is very weird. Can we just... Hello, welcome. And that is even weirder. We started so punctual, so wonderful. Now, can we address the elephant in the room, please? What is this accent I'm doing? My second time, because there was a 6:30 show. I've never done like a show just standing on stage as myself. I've always been like, I was playing Shakespeare just now, but right. It's weird because I'm not Shakespeare right now. I'm me. So, I'm usually in a show, I'm hiding behind a character, I have costumes and the whole thing, so I feel very exposed. And you weren't here at the 6:30 show where I was completely exposed. You can check it out on YouTube. So it's strange for me, it's uncomfortable for me, I'm having a good time, but I'm just thinking, okay, so what I'll do is I'll sing some songs from shows that I've done, right. I'll tell some stories, some behind the scenes tales, hits and misses, roles that I missed out on, backstage scuttlebutt, maybe drop a few names, like in Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, out of Portillo. At a particular like student matinee where the audience was just not enjoying it at all, and we were in the second act and Jackie Hoffman turned up stage and pantomimed blowing her brains out in the middle of the quiet bridge of pure imagination. I guess I'll just tell stories like that. But it's a little nerve-wracking, and I guess I just had to ask myself and everyone else, why did I decide to do this?
The money.
It's hard! It's hard! Fame, everyone knows my name, I can't help it, it's still freaking hard. All the places I would like to show you. Although I hardly know you, I've a funny feeling we make a perfect pair. Famous sights I wanna see you seeing, the nights of you and me and me.
Wait a minute, just a minute. No, 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 no.
I'm Joe with just one name.
Every night a bit a different name. Call each one of them the same pet name. Hey, baby.
In a row I have my ducks.
Loads of gals to give me loads of yucks.
Leave the cooing to the other clucks. I don't mean maybe. Got it good. What do I need with love? Always practice what I preach.
Out of easy reach. Stick to dolls who wash their hair and bleach.
I'm happy. Come and go the way I choose.
Never gonna sing the tie-dye blues.
All the guys who killed and built my shoes.
No wing clipped
sappy. Got it good. What do I need with love?
Oh, that was a near miss.
Talk about a close shave. Flirted with disaster. There must be someone.
Spoiler alert, all my shows have been bourbon tastings. So Michael Mayer, the incredible Michael Mayer, directed Thoroughly Modern Millie. And 14 years after that, I heard through the grapevine that he was going to be directing an off-Broadway production of Little Shop of Horrors. And I don't know, like 14-year-old 4'11 me got up some gumption and I called him up and I said, can I be your dentist? And he said, yes! When I was younger, just a bad little kid, my mama noticed funny things I did. Like shooting puppies with a BB gun. I'd poison guppies and when I was done, I'd find a pussycat.
Dentist.
People will pay you to be inhumane. You're telling me to
Say ah. Now spit.
Drink the Kool-Aid. You have to believe that you're doing something great. You're all in it together. That's, again, the glory of theater is you show up and you take what you're given and you all do your best. So we really thought we had something fantastic. And then we did it for an audience. And they didn't like it. But here's the really great part is at the beginning of the show, there's an overture, which is just done in pantomime before anyone sings a word. And at the end of the overture, when they blast the dun, 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 bum, 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 bang, there was a huge cross upstage, which you would expect, but the cross was made of like Klieg stadium lights. And as they hit the first chord, it blasted the audience with a blinding light that was so repellent that we on stage were looking at them and like we were like in like fedoras and like it was all very bizarre. And we got to see the looks on their faces. Hating it. And it only went downhill from there. True story. Barbara Walters left at intermission of opening night. When the reviews were bad, they said basically, the ensemble looks like there's something straight out of a Gap ad, which if you remember the year 2000, Gap had a very specific campaign and we looked like them. It was not appropriate for Jesus Christ Superstar. Jesus wore little ninja slippers, you know, the ones with like the toe divider. Not great. And they said that the ensemble looked like they were swatting at gnats the entire time. Because we were directed to gesticulate so much. You do not forget the bad reviews. And in that vein, I want to tell you a very brief story before we call it a night, because I see I'm running long. I did a wonderful show that means everything to me at Lincoln Center called Elegies by William Finn. It was a beautiful show. Listen to the album on Spotify. Or better yet, buy the CD! It was a gorgeous show. There were five people in it. I was the young person in the cast, relatively inexperienced, and we got a review from John Simon. I don't know if any of you have read John Simon, but he was a good writer, but he hated William Finn. Hated William Finn. I disagree. I think William Finn can do no wrong. So agree to disagree, John Simon. But there was a two-page spread in the New Yorker magazine where he was reviewing all these other shows, and then he got to Elegies, and it was two tiny little paragraphs. And the first paragraph was just like terrible excoriation of William Finn and everything that he stands for, everything that he's ever done, agree to disagree. And then here's the second paragraph of John Simon's Elegies review. Four performers, Betty Buckley, Carol Lee Carmelo, Keith Byron Kirk, and Michael Rupert, deserve better. The obnoxious Christian Borle, best at impersonating chickens and dogs, fits in perfectly. I did not have to look that up. It has burned in my brain since that time. But listen, we all have a different take on things. Okay, so this is a song that I got to watch Michael Rupert sing every night in that show. Every Thanksgiving, Mark made his all-male Thanksgiving dinner, where men cooked the turkey and men made the cranberry sauce without nuts, because men don't like nuts. But the stuffing was manly, the finger bowls ditto, and the ditto, the pureed sweet yams. Very manly when Mark made his all-male Thanksgiving. Bill Sherwood was present. He wrote and directed Party Glasses, a movie for which Mark raised the money, which Arthur invested, and the Thanksgiving crew put money into. Steve Buscemi was featured, his first time on screen, and you knew you were watching a star. God, he was great, but he wasn't at Mark's all-male Thanksgiving. Remembering this is sort of like Grandpa remembering his shtetl. It seems to take place so long ago, in the past. Memories last, but fade. What? A community we made. Diplomats, poets, opera guys, guys dressed in leather breeches. Some paunchy, some starting to bald, some were awful, and some were okay. In a non-threatening way, Mark the lawyer wore flannel. He comes from Wisconsin. The handsomest guy wore a tie. That was Arthur, sweetly decent, funny, and living. I met Arthur when Mark made his all-male Thanksgiving. And the excellent movie which Bill Sherwood filmed was his first and his last. Since the last the boy passed, Arthur still, when he smiles, he makes my heart flutter. We think it's been 22 years. I wrote this song to not forget Mark's all-male Thanksgiving. It's been so long since Mark made his all-male Thanksgiving. Where we
thank you.
legally blonde. And all that I will ask of you is that you just imagine this 17 years ago. I grew up in the Roxbury slums with my mom and a series of bums, guys who showed me all the ways a man can fail. I got through law school by busting my ass, worked two jobs in addition to class, so forgive me for not peeping at your tail. There's a chip on my shoulder, and as big as a boulder. With a chance I've been given, I'm gonna be driven as hell. I'm so close I can taste it, so I'm not gonna waste it. Yeah, there's a chip on my shoulder, you might wanna get one as well. So we did that reading, and then like a year later, this is gonna be like stories within the interstitial music. Are you excited? I am too. So like a year later, we did a bigger reading, like at music, standing at music stands, and the whole score was done, and we were basically selling it to investors and producers, like money people, like, do you want to do this on Broadway? And it went very well, and when it was over, we were all kind of backstage, and Jerry Mitchell came back, and he was really ebullient, and like just thrilled, over the moon. And I was like, what did they say? How did it go? And he was like, they loved it. It's going very well. And I was like, well, give me details. And he said, well, the big money producer came up to me. Jerry Mitchell is saying this to me, by the way. He said, the big money producer came up to me and he said, he only had one note. And I was like, what is it? And he said, his one note was, your Emmett isn't handsome enough. And I was like, uh-huh. And Jerry Mitchell said to my face, but I told him, that's the point. Well, I don't go to parties a lot, and I get used to the time that I got. Can't spend hours doing my hair and staying in shape. But I know it'll all be worthwhile when I win my first lucrative trial and buy my mom that great big house out on the Cape. Well, that's the chip on my shoulder. Another showbiz story. I was auditioning for a play directed by celebrity actor Stanley Tucci. Stanley Tucci, one of our great actors. He was directing a farce on Broadway, and I went in to audition for the ingenue. And it was like 10 pages of signs, which are the scenes you have to read at an audition. And it was early in my career, and I thought I would just go into these 10 pages of signs, and I would wing it. I would just be charming. I would be spontaneous. And so I got in the room, and there's Stanley Tucci, more handsome in person than you could even believe. And he let me do these signs, 10 pages. It took about 15 minutes, and I bombed. I was so bad. I didn't know what I was saying. I was buried in the script. And he very graciously said, let's try it again. And I did it again, 15 minutes later, head buried in the script. I will say, this is the last time I never memorized signs. So it was a learning experience. But Stanley Tucci comes around the table after I totally bombed and very sweetly stuck out his hand and said, and I quote, you're a very fine actor. I didn't get it. Well, this vanity's real picturesque, but it started its life as a desk. Clear it off and find some room for books instead. Can you live without this? Can you live without that? I don't know what that is.
It's for hair.
Wear a hat. Spend some time improving what's inside your head. Out, put it in storage, sell it on eBay, leave it behind. I did a commercial for eBay, went a little something like, when you can't seem to find a baseball that's been signed, that's on eBay. That's on eBay. By Tuesday, and it's on its way. All they used to say, you will be okay. That's on eBay. Oh. they're looking for the commercial. The breakdown said, looking for a Christian Borle type. So I went to the audition and I walked in looking like Christian Borle. This is my favorite show, this story, by the way. I don't know if you can tell, by the way, my shoulders are creaking up. But I walked in and all you had to do was sit at a table, and the gag was, Raisin Bran Crunch is so crunchy that when you're eating it, you can't hear what people are saying. So the only thing you had to do was take a spoonful of cereal and chew on it. I didn't get it.
Got colder, but with a chance you've been given, why are you not treating as hell? There's just no way around it. You gotta plow through till you found it.
Oh, Elle holds up a textbook, still in a shrink wrap.
Been reading it hard, I can tell. So finally, this is my last story. Not of the night, just of the song, sorry. I didn't get Spam-a-Lot three times before I got it. I went in, wasn't right, they gave it to an amazing actor, turned it down. I went in again, was not very good, gave it to an amazing actor, turned it down. Went in again, didn't get it, gave it to an amazing actor.
Turned it down!
So I finally went in the fourth time. It was in the basement of Lincoln Center. Mike Nichols, the amazing Mike Nichols, is sitting at the other side of the table, and I was bombing again. I was doing sides from the historian at the beginning of the show. You know, I'm a character actor, I'm putting on like a big character. And I was bombing. I could tell I was bombing again. I couldn't believe it. And I got to the end of it, and before they shoot me out of the room, I looked at Mike Nichols with what must have been like a pleading look on my face. And I said, is there something I'm not doing that you want me to do? And he so sweetly smiled at me and just said, yes. And he told me what to do, and I got it. Maybe some wise man told her, with a chance we've been given, we gotta be driven as hell. She wants something to see there. I'm just happy I can be there. She's fantastic, she tasted it. She's so low, she can taste it. She got a chip on her shoulder. Guess you never can tell. When little Miss Woods got mine.
I guess I'll have to do it myself.
We had so much fun together. We had a blast. We actually got into trouble. We made each other laugh so much that we got chastised by the associate director in a dressing room. But I thought it would be really nice if, like, Mary and Bert had this great rapport and we were always making each other laugh. But apparently they didn't think that. But I will tell you, one of the most challenging parts of that show, Bert is a fierce tapper, originated by Gavin Lee, ladies and gentlemen. The amazing Gavin Lee. I can't tap like Gavin Lee. I tried and I failed. So it was a learning curve for me, and I was doing the show, and my experience, in the middle of Step in Time, there's a moment where everything stops, and Bert sits on a chimney, and everyone on stage looks at Bert while he does a tap solo. And I was not very good at the tap solo. So I would look around the stage at this cast who'd been doing it for like 2.5 years, and they were all like this. This was how they looked at me while I was doing my tap solo. But then, like, over the course of the run, I got better. I was making better sounds, and like, as in anything you do over and over, I was improving, and I could hear it. So I felt really good about myself. And then I realized Sam Strassfeld, who was a Bert understudy and one of the greatest tappers in the show, was sitting stage right on a chimney, and he was mimicking my tap sounds, and they would turn up Sam's tap mics while I was doing my tap solo so that the audience would enjoy themselves. Better. It's fun. No, what I really need to get good at tap is 5 years and a pandemic, and then I'm really good at tapping. Something like that. I tap dance a lot. And we got that. Anyway, one of the most amazing parts of that show was the score, some of the fantastic songs, and I don't know if you know the story, but I'm going to tell it to you. The song "Feed the Birds" by the Sherman Brothers. There's a famous story that Walt Disney had a piano in his office, and at the end of a long day, if he was having a hard day, he would ask the Sherman Brothers, he'd call them into his office, and one of them would stand at the piano, the other one would sit and play, sing, play, and Walt Disney would sit in a chair and listen to them sing this song, and it would make everything better. Beautiful song. Take it away.
Early each day to the steps of St. Paul's, the little old bird woman comes in her own special way to the people she calls. Come. Buy my bags full of crumbs. Come feed the little bird, show them you care, and you'll be glad if you do. Their young ones are hungry, the nests are so bare, all it takes is tuppence from you. Feed the birds, tuppence a bag, tuppence a bag. Feed the birds, tuppence a bag.
Oh,
Oh my God. Oh my God, you guys. Oh my God.
Are you okay?
And you are?
Your right-hand man, sir.
Not anymore, Nate.
Not anymore!
More than words can tell.
my cigarette. What more can I say? I'll stay calm, untie my tongue, try to stay both kind and young. I was taught never brag or shout, still it's hot, just like how you read about. And all so caring and never too uncouth. That's the simple truth.